do consider using PCBWay for your next electronics project.
Hello YouTubers, and welcome to this video where we're going to take a look inside the SimCom Pump Saver. So you'll know in the previous video I did a review on this where I went through its kind of functionality and how it operates. And this video we'll take it to the bench where we'll take a look at the circuit to see how the components and the circuit perform. Now I've done a basic circuit diagram, so if I've made any mistakes then certainly folks can pick up on that. But I think for the most part I've got it sussed. I do have an interesting question about the way the current is measured and the shunt that they use. Also, they have gone and obscured the chips. Now, I know what the ICs or the chips are on here. We'll take a look under the microscope just to confirm their identification. But the main brains of this device is a PIC16 microcontroller. And if you haven't heard about that IC before, you may find this interesting because it's quite a versatile little IC. But anyway, let's take it down to the bench and take a closer look. Righty-ho, so you'll recognize this from the previous video. This is the front panel of the device. We've got two pots. One is to set the time, one is to set the sensitivity for when you're sensing the pump under dry run conditions or low power. We then have the input over here, input and output. So what I just want to show you, and I know someone queried this, and that's why I always say be wary of the wiring configuration that I've got on my bench. It's not necessarily done as per the exact instructions, or let's say the wire coloring. And on here we've got L1 in, L1 out, L1 in, L2 out, and you can see the line 2 side is switched. So here in the US, this would run, well, you can buy this to run either of 120 volts or 240. This one is for 240, in which case you've got your line 1, which is live and hot, and line 2, which is also live and hot, and the line 2 is switched. And those go in through these connectors over here. We then also have a set of LEDs to show status. I spoke about those in the previous video. The one is a run light, a calibration light, and depending on how they flash or what have you, they show various status conditions on the device. And then we've got an IR link to receive data from this device if you purchase another receiver which can receive that data. I just want to orientate ourselves because when we look underneath the microscope, it looks too close and you won't have your bearings on the board. But basically, the inputs happen on this side of the board. We have a relay, a transformer, and what we're going to have a look at now underneath the microscope is these three ICs. So this one happens to be a voltage regulator, LM317. We've then got an operational amplifier, and then we've got the PIC16 IC over here. So let's just go and take a closer look and see if we can identify those, because as you can see, those ICs have been obscured. So they've obviously painted something on top of them. I'm not sure whether they've tried to kind of rub them to obscure them, but we'll put them underneath the microscope and see the identification of them. Okay, so I might just insert a little picture to kind of orientate yourself as we go find these ICs. I'm doing this looking at a screen to the side, so it can be a little bit difficult. But this first IC, you can see it's been blacked out and in some cases scratched. But if I tilt that, there you go, you can see the LM317. So if I get my pointer, there's the LM317. So that one in the right light is fairly straightforward. We move on to the next one. And if I twist this one, you can just see there it is scratched, but this is the LM258, LM25 and then the 8. There's a bit of scratching on that besides being blacked out. So that is an operational amplifier. It's got two comparators. So that is the next one. And then we get to the brains of this device. So if you look very carefully, what's on there is PIC16F684. PIC16, and there's an F. If I tilt it, you can just see it, and 68, and then there's the number 4. So they've tried to obscure that, but in the right light, you can just about make out that detail.
Okay, so before we have a really close look at the circuit board, I'm just going to give you an overview as I see how the circuit works, and then we can try and pick it up from the board. And let's just quickly discuss that PIC16, because that is the main brains. So I will insert a little piece of the data sheet. I'm also going to give you a link to it, because if this half sparks your interest, I'm only mentioning a very small part of its capability. The PIC16, it's a programmable IC. It has 14 pins in this iteration. Two of those pins are the supply to run it. It has an operating range between 2 to 5.5 volts. If you look at the spec sheet, you can go slightly higher than that, but that's the normal operating voltage range. It can operate at a speed of up to 20 megahertz. That is reliant, obviously, on the external clock that you supply. It does have two internal clocks or two internal oscillators, but you can supply an external clock, and it can run at those higher speeds if you supply enough voltage. There is inside the data sheet what the maximum operating frequency of this IC is, dependent on the voltage that you supply to it. Now, although for the most part, you need to program this IC for it to do anything, it does have two analog comparators, and that isn't they don't rely on the programming. You can use those straight off. It does have an A to D converter, so an analog to digital converter. It's 10-bit with 8 channels. It's got 2 timers or counters. This does do timing when it receives a condition that causes this to trip. It then has a timer before it comes back online again. And for instance, when you get the rapid cycling, it then also has a counter which counts the number of times that it rapid cycles. So all of that is in the previous video, but it has that functionality built in. It has 2 internal oscillators. So the one you'll see in the spec sheet, it says 31 kilohertz. I think that's a misprint, because 32 would be the 32768 would be the standard oscillator frequency, and I think that is mentioned elsewhere. But then it also has another, it says precision oscillator, that goes from 125 kilohertz to 8 megahertz. Now, the interesting thing in the operation of this one, as we'll see when we take a closer look, it actually operates from the mains frequency. I mentioned this in the review. They particularly note that, for instance, the timing that you can set on the device. So if we have a look at the front, you've got this potentiometer on the front that will act as input to that PIC IC. You can go from 2 minutes all the way up to 225 minutes. But in the instructions for this, it notes that if you run this off 50 hertz, you have to add 20%. And that's what gave me the hint. It was obviously using the AC frequency as a clock. And I wonder why they did that. They could have used one of the built-in oscillators as a timing feature, but they didn't. Perhaps for simplicity, I'm not sure. It then has 128 bytes of static RAM and 256 bytes of EEPROM. So it certainly has enough memory to save the calibration data. It also saves various fault conditions and voltages and currents, and those can be read, those can be transmitted via a infrared data LED to another device. So you can hold the device up to this, and you can then actually read that data if you go and purchase that extra device. Then it also has a PWM module inside it, and as I said, there's a lot more. Now, the one thing to note is this has 14 pins. As I noted, two of them supply its running voltage and current, but then the rest can be configured for different functions. So most of these pins have two or three functions. They can be configured for analog input, digital output, or a clock in or clock out. So as you program this IC, you can change that functionality. So even for the relatively small number of pins that it's got, the functionality of those pins can be changed. So when we go and have a look at this, for the most part, I might not know what pin has been configured for what functionality. In some cases, we can take an intelligent guess because we can see what's being routed to it on the circuit board. But we'll have a closer look at that. Taking a look at the kind of really simplified diagram and function of this device, we're going to have 240 volts AC as noted via a line 1 and line 2. So here in the States, and again, I'll probably do a separate video on how the supply is configured in the US, because I know it's confusing for perhaps other folks in the world. But the supply that comes into one's home comes through a transformer where the secondary of that transformer is center tapped. So the two outside legs of the coil, between the two you get 240 volts. And just note, I know this is confusing. Our voltage in the US is 120, 240. Previously, it actually was 110, and then it moved up to 115, and then up to 120. And hence, it obviously went from 210, 230, and 240 volts. But the standard US voltage today is 120, 240. Now, between these two live legs that come off that center tap transformer, you've got a neutral. So between the neutral and one of the lives, you get 120 volts. So typically in a household, what they'll do is they'll balance the circuit. So hopefully half the load of the circuits goes to one of those legs between the neutral and the live, and then the other half of the circuits go to the other live and that shared neutral. That neutral is bonded to ground here in the US. So that's what we're getting to supply this unit. As I've noted, this unit can run off 120 or 240. In this case, we're working with 240. Where I have the connections over here, this would be the line 1 and line 2 inputs which come into these connectors over here. Those feeds go off to a transformer on the board. There is some rectification and filtering which then go to feed the LM317. So the LM317 is that voltage regulator, and although I haven't got any lines off this to try and keep this simple and not confuse issues, this will feed voltage and current. This will act as a supply for the rest of the circuit. So it'll feed the LM258 and it'll feed the PIC microcontroller. Also coming off this feed is the line which supplies the clock to run the PIC. So we get a feed coming off that. It goes through a high value resistor because you don't want any current coming in there. And that goes to a clock input on the PIC to run it at 60 Hertz. Now 60 Hertz in comparison to what this can run at is obviously a fairly slow speed, but then the functionality of the device doesn't really require high speed. We are talking a matter of seconds before this needs to respond to one of those trip conditions. So that's what they're doing, I expect, for simplicity. Then in terms of the voltage measurement, remember the two measurements that this needs to take into account so that it can unmonitor the status of the pump and either trip this or keep it running. It needs to monitor the voltage and the current. The two parameters that it works on is either the current or the power. Now, as noted, so if we get too much current usage, it can trip. But when the well runs dry, it monitors the power. So for that, it would need both the voltage and the current, and then internally, it can work out the power. It obviously takes those into account when you put it into its calibrate mode. It'll measure both the voltage and the current, and it'll store those for its calibration in the memory. So there, it takes a feed off, and I've noted off line 2, goes into that op amp, and there's a feed, the other leg of the measurement comes off, in fact, just past the resistor where this line is used for the clock in. It takes a second measurement, voltage measurement, over here. So that goes into the op amp. Obviously, the signal, what it does is it amplifies that signal so it gets to a nice level for the PIC microcontroller.
When it comes to the current measurement, this I found quite interesting. You'll see when we look at the board, we've got two resistors, and these, I'm thinking, well, they can only be the shunt resistors. Now, normally, when you have a shunt to measure high current, it'll be in series with a circuit. Now, this circuit is rated to carry, or this device, I should say, is rated to carry about 17 amps, as I recall. So you certainly couldn't pass 17 amps directly through these resistors. Normally, you would have a metal shunt with very low resistance in series, in circuit, and you'd be measuring millivolts off that to understand what your current is. So you'd measure that voltage drop from the very low resistance shunt in order to derive your current. But in this case, what they're doing, they've actually got a track on the PCB which passes straight through. It comes straight through from the L2 input and goes to the relay, which is where it's switched. But then what they do is they take two metal element resistors, they put them together in parallel. They're both rated for 3 watts. They are 5 ohm, so 2 5 ohm in parallel will give you 2.5 ohm in effect. So what's happening is the majority of your current is passing straight through without any issue through the device, say to the relay. And then a small proportion of that, because you've got some resistance here, but it'll allow some current flow through these two resistors and then back out to the rest of the circuit. So this, for me, I've not seen this configuration before, and that's where I'm keen for input to see whether this is a normal configuration. I was looking for other examples and I couldn't find them, but it's just unusual the way it's done, that the shunt is in parallel to the circuit and not directly in series. They're just allowing some current to pass through, and obviously as the current changes, it's going to change proportionally through these resistors. And then what they're doing off here is there are two feeds off here. We go through another, I think it's a 10K resistor over here. And again, because you don't want any high current flowing to your delicate electronics over here, so you've got a high impedance. It takes the feed off that for the voltage measurement. So we come into the op amp. The op amp will create a signal which is nicely readable by the PIC16 microcontroller. So we come out of there, it'll provide a voltage input into the microcontroller. Likewise, we get a voltage input into the microcontroller. One will be used to measure the voltage, and the one is obviously measuring the current. So those are the two key measurements that the PIC needs in order to decide whether we've got a normal running of the pump, which you've got connected to this, whether there's an overcurrent or an undercurrent. This can also measure an overvoltage or undervoltage as well. So it can pick that up from these pickups which are going into the op amp. We've then got the microcontroller. And then, so the microcontroller, if you haven't had experience with them before, it is a self-contained computer. And that is the beauty about this little IC, to think that this IC has got a self-contained computer. It has a microprocessor to do the processing. It's got I/O, so it can have input and output. It has got onboard memory. It has got onboard counters and clocks. So a really versatile little chip. We've already spoken about the input that it gets from the op amp in terms of measuring the current and the voltage. It then also gets analog inputs. So the one thing I want to highlight, so these are all analog inputs. Remember, it's got multiple channels to read analog inputs. So you've got analog input here, analog input for over here for the voltage measurement. The timer, we've got a potentiometer, so a variable resistor. That'll provide an analog reference voltage. Likewise with the low power sense, another variable resistor. So that'll provide act as a voltage divider, so it provides a variable analog voltage input to this device so that it can set the low power sense or the various time for the trip status. We then have our output. The output in this case is to go and switch the relay, either to break the circuit if there's a trip, or to reset the circuit to get it running again. It'll close the relay. And then we also have that infrared LED, which is transmitting data. So we've got digital data being transmitted through that LED. And if you go and look up any of these PIC microcontrollers, there are numerous models of them which have more functionality, or they might have more I/O or less I/O. They may have better operating conditions in terms of temperature and what have you. But there are lots of projects that you can go and do with these to go and drive. You could drive your digital displays out. You can have lots of digital input into this. So a really versatile device. So let's go and take a closer look now at the circuit and see if we can track where that all happened. Okay, so let's start off with the input side of this. So here we've got the line one in and the line one out. And as you can see, we've got a straight connection to this, so it can carry high current out. On this side of the board, we've got the high current, high voltage stuff. And then you can see the actual cuts into the board to provide isolation. So we've got isolation between this side of the board and what's happening on this side of the board over here with the sensitive electronics. Over on this side, we've got the line two in and the line two out. You'll see the cutout again to provide isolation. This is where we find those two metal element resistors. So these have a low temperature coefficient, which would make them good as shunts. So if there's a change in temperature, they're not going to change their resistance and hence the voltage drop across them. If you look carefully on the board, these two ends of the resistor are common. There is a track going underneath, or there's a track on top here, which joins these two pads. And likewise, there is a big pad, if I can get the light right, you can see under here, which joins these two ends of the resistors. So these two are in parallel. And if you look very carefully, we will see the one side of the voltage measurement. So you can see there is a line, and then this is a resistor going to, there's a little pad. I'll show you these two little pads. These are the two pads which come from either side of this resistor pairing over here. So what we're having a look at now is those two pads I just showed you on the PCB. I've represented with these two dots on the circuit over here. One of the pads gets a direct feed from this side of those two resistors coming out, and then the other from the other side, so it can get measure the voltage drop to understand what the current flowing through this part of the circuit is, and that is going through a high value resistor over here before we get to these two pads, which then go to the op amp over here. This might be a little tricky to get in view. I do have a multimeter here so I can check continuity. Those pads are quite difficult to get to, but there is the one on the one side of those resistors. And then if I catch it on the right side of that resistor, if I go on this side, obviously the impedance or the resistance is too high. I'm not going to get continuity. But there we go. That is the connection from this side of this resistor going through that surface mount resistor over there to that pad over there. Before we jump too deeply into the rest of the circuit, just look at the basics of where the AC voltage comes into the transformer and goes out the other side. So on this side, we've got a track which goes across over here and goes into the one pin of the primary side of the coil. And then the other line or other live side comes through. There is a via going to the other side of the PCB, but then it comes up over here, it passes around, and it passes underneath and goes to the other side of the coil for the primary of the transformer. It also then takes a path around here to this high value resistor, which then passes through, and that supplies both the one side for the voltage measurement and then the 60 hertz clock cycle to run the PIC. On the secondary side of the transformer, we've got the rectification happening, so we get closer to DC. We've got two diodes here. They are marked on the silk screen just underneath the transformer. And then we've got an electrolytic capacitor to provide our filtering.
So rectification with filtering, and then that goes into our LM317. So this then provides a nice stable voltage to power the rest of the circuitry on the board. Also on top of the board, we've got the LEDs. I'll show you in a different view. These are very small surface mount LEDs, which show the status, whether it is run, calibrate, or the various trip modes. There is a hole going through the PCB and then a pass through to conduct the light through to the top side of the PC board. We'll take a look at that in a moment. The IR LED is sitting over here, so the control circuitry. There is a little transistor, so there will be an output going from the PIC16 over here, which controls the data that's being transmitted by the IR LED over here. Then we've got these pads noted as FD3. There's an FD2 over here. I'm assuming these are test points when this is in production. So these are test points, which I presume are picked up. We've also got this little 2-pin connector over here, labeled as H2. There is an H1 silkscreen over here, but there's nothing connected. I'm assuming that this might be some type of output, which could be activated maybe. There's nothing within the casing which would allow a connection to this. I don't know whether perhaps if it goes into a certain state, whether it trips or what have you, you could have some external indication via this. I'm not sure. We've then got our pots. We've then got our pads over here for the programming. So you can connect to this IC while it's in circuit and program it while it's in circuit, which is a really nice feature. And these are the pads which link up to allow you to do that. Now let's just have a look at, you can just see in the video over here, it's actually obscured, I'm just checking on the camera. These are the two pads which picked up the voltage drop from the shunt. So we're going to trace where those go to. So I've got my test lead on one of those pads. And if I run my other one across the op amp, there we go. So I think that is the top pin, and I can't recall whether that's the inverting or non-inverting. I'll throw up a little diagram here. So that is a top pin. If I go to the other pad, that is the second pin down that I'm touching. So it's very difficult. I've got this angled the way I'm trying to stare at the camera. But those are the two inputs to the comparator or the op amp. And then the third pin down is the output. So if I just carefully go on there and I sweep across the PIC. And yeah, I think it's a top pin. That top pin, again, can be configured for a lot of functionality, input, output. But in this case, that pin is being configured as an analog input. Then the next thing I'm going to show you is the clock input. So what I'm going to do is I'll try and keep this like this so we can see everything. This comes directly from line one, comes through this high value resistor to avoid any current flow through here, and then we'll pick up where it goes to on the PIC. So in this case, it is this second pin. Now bear in mind, I forget the orientation of this, and I say I'll insert a little diagram here so you can actually see it, but that is going to, from where I'm sitting, the second pin down on the left hand side, and that is the clock input to this device. Now we'll pick up if we sweep, not on this side, and I'm sweeping, what I'm doing, I was looking to see where the voltage measurement went, but it obviously doesn't go directly into the PIC. It has to go into the op amp first. So let's have a look. The other comparator is on the other side of the op amp over here. So that is that second pin on my right hand side. So I'll just, again, I'll insert the diagram and show you there. So that is the one side of the voltage measurement. If I go to ground, I'm just going to place my other probe on the other side of the line. So in fact, that was line one. Now I'm going to line two, just out of view over here. And there we go. That is the other input to the comparator. Now if we try and track the output from the comparator to the PIC, that is going to be this bottom pin. And if I just sweep, there we go. It is that pin over there in terms of an analog input into the PIC. So that covers both the voltage and the current measurement. And the way the PIC works, it'll cycle through. You can set various commands to go and read the analog inputs to digitize it. And when it digitizes that, it stores it. I believe there are two registers that it immediately stores the binary value of the analog reference that's come in. You also have a reference voltage, which you can set within the PIC. And once you've got that value inside the registers, you can then copy that or transfer that to your more permanent non-volatile memory inside the PIC. Then, as mentioned, our other input into the PIC is done through these two variable resistors over here. We've got our sensitivity one over here. It'll act as a voltage divider. It'll have a leg which is going into another analog input inside the PIC. Likewise with the timer. We can go and set a time, it's a voltage divider, it'll have an analog reference voltage coming into the PIC as well. When a condition exists that creates a trip, or whether it needs to reactivate the relay over here, there's a control line going through, and we can see over here on the board is a surface mount transistor. That surface mount transistor will act as the control to either energize or de-energize this relay, which will then allow the current to pass straight through. There's a track on the board. You can see this big pad, and that goes underneath to allow L2 to be switched. We've got the incoming current from L2 going through. Remember, it passes in parallel to these two shunt resistors. This pad takes it underneath, and then it'll pass out as it is switched to this output over here. And then just to have a look at the mechanics of how the light from the LEDs is passed through to the top of the board, which you see when you're operating it. We've got the little surface mount LEDs over here, and then the IR LED over there. And then if we look inside the sandwich, you can see the tubes, the plastic tubes which are coming through. So you've got a hole which is drilled through the board. So you've got the LED on the top. The light then comes through that hole. It's transferred through this plastic pipe, in effect, and then you've got the roughened top over here to disperse the light and make it more visible. So you've got your two control lights over here and your IR link LED over there. And if we just do go and trace one of the inputs from one of these adjustable pots, which will provide the act as a voltage divider, and add a voltage, an analog voltage, which the PIC reads, if I just slide across. So from my side, that looks like the third pin down. So that'll be another analog input which can be configured. And then from this pot, and that's the third pin down from where I'm sitting, basically. Also another analog input.
So there you go. I hope you kind of had a look at that, look inside an overview of the internal workings of this device. I'm certainly no electronics fundi, so there's certainly, I could be making some mistakes with where I see things going, but as you can see, you know, what may seem like a complicated circuit if you're not very au fait with PCBs and electronic components, once you start carefully tracing them out, you can soon get a reasonable understanding of how things hang together and how it works. Most of the magic obviously happens inside that PIC16 IC, because all of the programming happens there to take the inputs, the readings from the current, or the voltage drop across a shunt to give you a current reading, to then take a reading for the voltage. From that, it can derive the power. It can then, from the stored calibration, do comparisons with what it's saved in memory to constantly look at the voltage, current, power, and see whether you've got an overcurrent status or an under power status when the well runs dry, and then actuate the relay to stop the pump from running. It can obviously send data out through the IR LED. So yes, it's a very nice device, and it just shows you how versatile and how powerful just that one little IC is in this device. But anyway, I hope you gain some enjoyment from that, and I'll catch you soon for the next video. Cheers.
Do consider using PCBWay for your next electronics project.